Welcome back to what has been an amazing adventure in Devon and Cornwall. In today's episode, I'll be sharing with you the daily activities and sights that we saw across our two-week trip in the area. I'm also going to share on my Google Maps where I've pinned the locations I visited and the overall budget for the trip. We'll dive right in with the itinerary. On the Friday night after work, we drove from London to a very rural place just south of Dartmoor National Park where we stayed for 3 nights, allowing us to explore areas within the national park and eat at the nearby Riverford Field Kitchen. On the Monday, we drove further west to another incredibly rural place, the hamlet of Trenwheel. We stayed here for a whole week, allowing us to explore places virtually on the doorstep, such as Godolphin, Praa Sands for Coasteering, and St Ives' Park and Ride, as well as, with a bit more of a drive time, the Lizard Peninsula, Porthcurno, Land's End, Minack, and the Mining Coast too. The following Monday, we said goodbye to Trenwheel and headed to another rural spot just outside of Bodmin, stopping off at Glendurgan along the way. We stayed in a shepherd's hut in Nanstallon for 4 nights, allowing us time to cycle the Camel Trail into Padstow, zip around the sea on a jet ski safari, marvel at St Nectans Glen, and walk a stretch of the southwest coast path from Boscastle to Tintagel. Our final 2 nights, we stayed with friends at their place in Somerset, giving us time to visit Cheddar Gorge, Burramump, and also just hang out. The daily activities. On our first proper day, we enjoyed an 8-course lunch at the Riverfords Organic Farm, trying plenty of veg-centric dishes in a wonderfully decorated dining space. The afternoon was spent trying to shed some of the calories just consumed by undertaking a self-guided tour around the farm, checking out the beehives, lakes, and curious veg inside the polytunnels. On the Sunday, we headed to the northern end of the National Park and started our day with a visit to the National Trust's Castle Drogo. We explored its wider estate, formal gardens, and gawked at the extravagant interior. After a quick bite for lunch at their cafe, we headed across to Finch Foundry, another National Trust property, but this one was an old forge where we got to see the process in action, powered by the beautiful water wheels out back. On the Monday, we said goodbye to the shepherd's hut that we'd spent the weekend in, making use of its private meadow, the gorgeous hot outdoor shower, experiencing for the first time a composting loo that was actually really rather pleasant, and in the evening, enjoying roasted marshmallows around the campfire to make s'mores. We headed towards the National Trust's Lydford Gorge, where we undertook a 5-kilometre walk. We began up high, taking a few moments to be a big kid on an unusually deserted playground. Wandered amongst the trees, crossing cute bridges as we went. After a sharp descent, the true beauty of the place shone from the White Lady waterfall, narrow gorges, boardwalks, tunnels, and more bridges. Lydford Gorge was an absolute highlight of our 2-week trip and a place that I'd love to return to, especially in the autumn. On the Tuesday, we woke up in Cornwall and threw ourselves in at the deep end, quite literally. We joined a coasteering tour at Praa Sands where we swam in the sea, scrambled up sea cliffs and flung ourselves off them. The team of guides were wonderful, ensuring our safety along the way and providing plenty of encouraging words as the wild and rugged platforms that we jumped from became higher, scarier or more technical. We adored this activity and through it got to see the Cornish coastline from a very unique perspective. The afternoon was spent exploring Praa Sands beach on foot, clambering over the boulders at the far end, and watching on as people bodyboarded and kitesurfed in the water. Wednesday was spent learning about the mining heritage in Cornwall. I visited both the Levant Mine's beam engine, being given a tour and seeing the thing in action, and wandered a small section of the southwest coast path to Botallack to see its crown engine houses. The afternoon was spent meandering through the tropical pathways at Trengwaetan Gardens, made possible by the warm Gulf Stream that hits Cornwall. Thursday saw us back on the southwest coast path again, but this time hiking from the southernmost point of the mainland UK, Lizard Point, along to the beautiful Kynance Cove. After scoffing down a gigantic Cornish pasty, the tide had dropped, allowing us to wander onto the white sand beach, only visible at low tide. As the weather took a turn, we walked back via the inland shortcut, which provided a moment of hilarity.
Oh, that's crazy!
We enjoyed watching on as a fisherman returned from a shift at work and demonstrated just how physically demanding his job is. Friday was spent visiting St Ives for the day. With a heads up about expensive and difficult to locate parking, we drove to St Erth Station car park, and took one of the most beautiful train rides in the UK into town. We passed walkers on the southwest coast path and numerous gorgeous white sand beaches too. St Ives was a bit of a shock to the system as it was incredibly busy and a lot of the day was spent wandering around rather aimlessly. We did, however, pick up some cracking food from Cornish ice cream to heather cake and the rather decadent saffron buns. On the Saturday, we visited Godolphin, a National Trust property on the doorstep of our Airbnb cottage. We wandered around the odd internal parts of the property open to day visitors, its gardens, stables, and then set off on a hike around its wider estate. The cows made for an interesting trig point at the top, and the insects were fascinating, from spiders with their impressive webs through to a butterfly and an ant battling it out. Turns out, in a fight, a tiny ant will win. Who knew? Once back at the main house, we had a traditional cream tea where I tested out Cornwall's jam first versus Devon's cream first to see which was better, and trying to shed the calories afterwards with a quick game of badminton in their gardens. Sunday was the absolute highlight of our trip. We started at Porthcurno Beach where we caught a quirky open-top double-decker bus across to Land's End, where we embarked upon a 5-mile hike along the southwest coast path. Whilst Land's End wasn't my cup of tea, as soon as we walked away from it, the landscape turned into absolute paradise. We saw sea arches, sea stacks, turquoise waters, landslips, sea caves, brightly coloured wildflowers, open farmers' fields, cute villages, boulder beaches, sandy beaches, wildlife, and a whole hike was topped off with a performance at the world-renowned Minack Theatre. The weather was perfect and my feet were grateful for the rest. The performance was witty and clever, but the setting amongst the brightly coloured gardens and the turquoise bay and sea cliffs in the distance was just perfect. After the performance, it was an easy downhill climb from the theatre to Porthcurno Beach, looking on at the white sands and the even more turquoise water, feeling like we were somewhere in Greece or the Caribbean, not England. On the Monday, we checked out of our super retro Airbnb cottage set within amazing grounds, and we headed further up the county, stopping off at the National Trust's Glendurgan Garden for the day. We enjoyed seeing exotic species, getting lost in the rather impressive maze, descending into the tropical valley, and finally getting pushed out onto Durgan Beach on the Helford estuary. It's a playful National Trust property, rather different to the ones that I visited, and worth it for kids and grown-ups alike. Thursday gave us a new area of Cornwall to discover, so we headed to the nearby Bodmin to rent a couple of bikes. We cycled the 26-mile round trip along the spectacular Camel Trail, taking in the River Camel, the small nods back to the trail being an old railway line, and thoroughly enjoyed a Rick Stein's fish and chip takeaway. We naturally had nosy around Padstow, but with the epic bike ride back, time was pushed. There were several bike rentals in Wadebridge, which is an alternative place along the Camel Trail, that would give more time in Padstow and less time on the bikes if that's more your cup of tea. Wednesday was glorious and arguably the best weather of the whole trip. We started our day at Carlyon Bay, where we undertook a 90-minute jet ski safari. We whizzed around like big kids, saw different areas along the Cornwall coastline, and even spotted some porpoises off in the distance. The rest of the day was relatively uneventful, getting lunch from the food trucks and lazing on the beach, taking advantage of what felt like rare sun rays. We were staying in another cute shepherd's hut in this area, and as it had a barbecue in the garden, we again, grabbing that rare bit of warm British weather by both hands, we had a barbecue and ate al fresco. Thursday, by stark contrast, was arguably our worst weather day of the whole trip. We had a lazy lion and frantically searched for indoor activities, realising that options such as the nearby Bodmin Jail, the steam railway and the Eden Project were all sold out. And eventually the heavens lightened, so we headed across to St Nectans Glen. A gentle walk up a forested valley and stream led us to a slightly pricey entry point, but the waterfall itself was pretty spectacular and with the unique hole in the rock for its final drop. Friday's weather was marginally better. We drove to Tintagel, stashed the car and hopped on a bus bound for Boscastle. From here we got rained on, several times. The blowhole at the entrance to the harbour was impressive, and from there we walked along the southwest coast path, witnessing some of the craziest waves, impressive sea stacks, a lady's window, and a gorgeous valley gorge that reminded me of Scotland's fairy pools. Eventually, the path led us back to the car in Tintagel via Merlin's Cave. We cheated a bit on the Saturday and spent the day in Somerset completing a circular hike around Cheddar Gorge, eating a delightful lunch at the Beer Cider Company, where a pint of cider was the same price as a coffee, and taking a curious look at Borough Mumps before heading home on the Sunday. The budget. The aim had been £1,000 per person for 2 weeks based on two of us taking the trip together, and this budget was for everything from fuel, accommodation, food, activities, parking, and even coffees. We went just shy of £30 over budget, which in the grand scheme of things I wasn't about to lose sleep over. The accommodation was overwhelmingly our biggest expense at £472.74. We ensured that all our accommodations were self-catering, which may have made it slightly more expensive, but we were able to then save a lot of money by not needing to eat out every day. Our snacks and drinks total was £38.80, consisting of a lot of coffees, and then other tidbits like ice creams, cream teas, and so on. Whilst our lunches, which I deem as a meal, for example, a giant Cornish pasty, takeaway fish and chips, an 8-course lunch, cafe bites like soups and sandwiches, and not to forget the most disappointing crab taco known to man, all came out to £145.61. Our supermarket shops that saw us through breakfasts, dinners, snacks, and some packed lunches came to £95.37. Much more expensive than if I was at home, but when travelling, I often buy more expensive but less hassle foods to save on time. Think quick cook pastas and store-bought pizzas. Our fuel total was a pleasant surprise after the cost of Scotland the previous summer at £35 per person, but looking back, London is much closer to Devon and Cornwall. Parking was on the pricey side when you consider that this was half of what we spent as a couple, and we parked for free on several days as National Trust members. This totaled £13.15, and we used public transport three times, costing a total of £11. Two bus rides were so that we could do one-way hikes, whilst a train journey was in part because parking is notoriously bad in St Ives, but also because I'd heard that the train journey itself is epic, and it was. The final expense was for the activities I've already mentioned, and this came out at £218.05. The budget spreadsheet has also broken down the itinerary, which details where we stayed overnight, what our activity for the day was, a breakdown of what money was spent on, as well as how much. You may wish to pause the video if you want to see this in more detail, and if you've got any questions about what you see on this, please just ask away in the comments and I'm happy to answer them. My Google Maps. I've also put together an interactive Google Maps and I'll leave a link in the description below. I've tried to choose an icon design that gives a hint as to what each pin represents, but if you click on each one, I've tried to include a photo of the location, along with written details such as what we did, links if we used a company, parking, availability and costs, or anything else that you might find helpful. I'd love to know if any of this video has been helpful to you. Are you planning a trip, looking for inspiration, or just watching for pure nostalgia? Please let me know in the comments below, along with any questions that you have. If you found this video helpful, you might be interested in my 20 episode long Devon and Cornwall travel vlog series, so click on the playlist if you want to find out more.